Right, so I'd like to welcome you to this seminar, and we have a return from a number of years ago of Hank Dykstra. Hank was background is in applied mathematics from the University of Groningen, Netherlands. After that, he came to Cornell back when there was a mathematical sciences institute here. That may date him for some of you. And at that time, we worked on some transport problems that were related to his PhD thesis.
That's an old one.
In NASA-related transport and Marangoni flows. So he left Cornell then to take a position in Utrecht at the Institute for Marine and Atmospheric Research. And at that turn in his career, he decided to change subjects completely. And all the evidence suggests it was a very wise move. There is some continuity with his Cornell career, at least I like to think there is, because if you look at the chapters in his very popular nonlinear physical oceanography book, they use dynamical systems that I think smell of his time here. So Hank is, has continued to grow in terms of his stature. He's internationally known for bringing this dynamical systems approach to nonlinear physical oceanography. He's been an expert reviewer, for example, he's been an expert reviewer on the third assessment report of the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change. Where are we now? What is the one that was just out?
Fifth. For the sixth is in preparation.
And in addition to this nonlinear physical oceanography book, he has a couple more recent books on dynamics of climate change, related to dynamics of climate change. And so I'd like to just, before I step away, there are two other talks Hank's giving. One is on Monday, computationally related, in the SCAN seminar. It's called Computational Challenges in Climate Dynamics. And then that's at noon, 125, 406 Gates Hall, 125, 406 Gates, Computational Challenges in Climate Dynamics. And the second is on next Tuesday, the 20th of October, 178 Rhodes, in the Cornell Fluid Dynamics Seminar. He'll speak on the fluid dynamics of El Nino. Please.
Thank you very much, Paul. Everybody can hear me, also at the back. Good. So you're all going to be affected, whether you like it or not, by climate change in the next decades. And one particular issue which is highly relevant is sea level change. And that's why I put this beautiful picture up here. You probably won't recognize it, but it's near the Maldives in the Indian Ocean. And there it's projected that if we have about 1 meter sea level rise, which is near the projections for the end of next century, that all the sort of islands of the Maldives will be underwater. So actually, they're really thinking of buying land in Australia or elsewhere to really move the whole population. So this is some of the impacts of climate change. The global sea level is rising by about 3 millimeters per year, but it's very regionally very inhomogeneous. Some places it's actually going down, some places it's going up. So knowing, say, the processes in the climate system and knowing what kind of phenomena they cause, in particular also sea level change, is a crucial, say, of crucial importance. So this is a first talk. Now I see it shifted a bit. The first talk, I want to give an overview of how would you approach phenomena of climate variability from a dynamical systems point of view. It will be relatively introductory, showing you, a typical example of, so how do you approach this problem from this point of view. Now, if you look at the Earth climate system, it has, say, input of periodic forcing, so the daily variations of incoming radiation. Of course, you have seasonal variations, and when you go to longer time scales, you have variations of insolation, so that's radiation at the top of the atmosphere due to orbital variations of the Earth. And it eventually goes through a very complex, say, system involving ocean, atmosphere, land, ice, and eventually you get a signal out of there which is quite irregular and difficult to understand. So this is where we're talking about. How do we actually understand these type of records we get out of the climate system? So Paul already introduced me, so I don't have to repeat that. I'm happy to be here, and I thank Paul very much for, say, supporting this visiting professorship. I hope to really start some new collaborations with people over here, and starting already with that.
So maybe we should say you'll be here each semester for the next six semesters for 2 to 3 weeks.
That's right.
He has conflicting responsibilities as head of the physics and astronomy department in Utrecht, so this is the way.
It's difficult to come a bit longer, but 2-3 weeks is nice. So the roadmap of my talk will be, I introduce you to the phenomena of climate variability, which I do mainly through patterns of sea surface temperature variability. This is the variable we understand and we've observed best. And I spent a bit of time on what is called the null hypothesis of this variability. I think it's important to know that there's some underlying view of what causes the variability, which we call the null hypothesis. And then go into, say, sketching this dynamical systems approach, talking about climate model hierarchy. There's a whole hierarchy of models to describe this phenomena. Really touch a little bit on the mathematical computation techniques, although I will talk about that on Monday more in detail. And then do one case, which I picked, the Atlantic Multi-Decadal Oscillation, because I know that Andrew Roberts is working on this. So there's one, actually somebody working here on the topic. I show some phenomena on this, and then eventually, of course, using this whole framework, we'll sketch a theory of this variability. So that's the program for today. This is the mean sea surface temperature. I hope you can read it in the back. This is the blue here is 5 degrees and goes up to 29 degrees. And this is from the satellite era. So this is the best measured data, global measured data from 1982 to 2008 here. It's in a review paper here, very nice review paper by Clara Desser et al. And it sketches, well, broadly, you would not be very surprised. It's warmer at the equator, and it's colder near the poles due to the radiation imbalance at the poles and in the equator region. There's some phenomena which look a bit strange here. This is the, for instance, the east-west gradient here in temperature, where you have relatively cool temperatures here. There's also a strange phenomena here where you see that it's relatively much warmer here in the North Atlantic compared to the Pacific. So there are all kinds of things which are related to, say, ocean currents and climate dynamics. But then what we're interested in mostly in sea surface temperature is in its variability. And you can plot, for instance, the standard deviation over this whole period. So you take a point, compute the time series, compute the variance, and plot it. And then you see this is a standard deviation of about 1.5 maximum degrees. And it's localized in certain spots. Here, this is associated with high variability in the eastern Pacific, associated with El Nino. Then you see the variability here near the western boundaries of the coasts, here in North America, here, say, Japan, which is associated with very strong ocean currents. And then there's some features here in the Southern Ocean where you have very much high variability. So this sketches a bit the overall variance of the system if you look at sea surface temperature. Now, let's focus on that particular equatorial part. I just mention it because there's a big El Nino building up, and if you're interested, you can follow it really developing on the internet. It will have a maximum in December, we know that. It's somehow around December, and it's projected to be quite a strong signal. This is the one from 1997, 1998, at its maximum in December 1997. And this is the anomaly with respect to a long-term mean. So you compute, say, a 1982-2010 mean, and then you subtract the actual December 1999 monthly average from that mean, or the other way around, of course, and then you get the anomaly. And that shows you that you have a large area here in the eastern Pacific where the temperature is bigger than, say, 4 degrees. Now, you can also make an index of that, of course, and you want to follow that signal in time. So you take a box here. This is called the Niño 3.4 box. I mean, this is history why those terminology is so strange. And then you can take the average of the anomaly over this box and plot it, say, as a function of time. And then you get really an index of the, say, El Niño variability, showing that 1997 was quite a strong El Niño, also 1982. There's extrapolations, and of course there are limited data, say, back to the about 1900, but of course the most accurate records are, say, from 82, where we had, say, satellite data. And you can make a spectrum of this time series, and you get a broad spectrum with, you have a peak at around 4 years, right? So a nice topic for a PhD student. Every 4 years you have a phenomenon. So let's focus on this null hypothesis, because El Niño, we know for sure that it's something which is dynamically induced, but the null hypothesis is important to know. And let's focus, for instance, on this variability here in the North Pacific. Sea is not really particularly strong, but it's stronger than, say, many of the areas around it. And when you then make a spectra, so these are spectra measurements at this sort of area, you average them, and this is the black curve. There are two different data sets, so they have different names. This is from UK, this is from the US, and ignore the curve, the red and the green one for the moment, just focus on the black one. Now, of course, you have very limited data because the time series is relatively short. This is a limitation, so you see for the spectra, it's not, you have not much, say, range in that spectrum. But you see that it there is a decay here at the high frequencies, and there's a more, say, stabilization when you go to low frequencies. And people have wondered, try to explain this. What's the mechanism behind this type of variability in this area? And the first one coming up with this is Klaus Hasselmann. He was the director of the Max Planck Institute in Hamburg. And he came up with a paper in 1976 about stochastic climate models. And the model he considered is what we call not a dynamical model, it's more a thermodynamical model. It's a very simple model of the mixed layer ocean. So you have a mixed layer ocean. In the upper ocean, you have the wind and the buoyancy forcing that you mix this upper ocean very well. And then you get a nearly homogeneous temperature here. And of course you have the heat fluxes, say, from the atmosphere, or vice versa, from the ocean to the atmosphere. But there is a heat flux, and we take it always positive when it goes into the ocean. And then you try to model this, say, system of coupled ocean-atmosphere interaction. So you assume that the mixed layer depth is fixed, that it's about 50 to 100 meters at these middle latitudes, and you have a highly fluctuating atmosphere, which is due to the weather phenomena over it. So this is some of the problem you consider. There's nothing to do with ocean circulation, pure sort of thermodynamic, how the heat is actually transported from the atmosphere in the ocean and vice versa. And when you then, say, generate this model, and these are, I have not much many equations there, but this, I thought it was manageable. I mean, certainly this is the heat equation. So rho is the density, Cp is, of course, heat capacity. This is a thermal conductivity. And then you have boundary conditions where you have the heat flux here. And this is reasonably well, say, represented by a linear relation with the temperature difference. So when Ta is positive, bigger than T, you have heat flux coming into the ocean, increasing the temperature of the mixed layer. At the bottom, you assume there's no heat transport. And what you can do then is, take this vertically integrated temperature, and you get eventually, for the vertically integrated temperature, you get this equation, where this gamma is related to this alpha over rho range. So this is the model, very simple one. And then you know that this Ta is a highly fluctuating quantity. And so the step which Hasselmann took is, say, okay, you have this timescale separation of slowly developing ocean mixed layer, which is due to the high, say, thermal inertia, so the high heat capacity, and you have this very fluctuating atmosphere which fluctuates on, say, the daily time scale as the ocean adjusts on months to years. So you have this timescale separation, and so you model this, say, this fluctuating atmosphere, you model it as a white noise function. White noise, this is basically a distribution, but this is the white noise representation. And so this was the first, say, how stochastics came into the climate field as a stochastic model just representing this ocean response to highly fluctuating atmosphere. Now, of course, this is when you look at this as a stochastic differential equation, you get this Langevin equation, where this is the standard Brownian motion. And this is a well-known process due to Ornstein Uhlenbeck. I put him up here because Ornstein is actually from Utrecht, from the same department where I am now. And he was sort of at the base of this, this process. Now, when you look at, say, the stationary autocorrelation function, you see that it's exponentially decaying. And if you look at the spectrum of this stationary, say, distribution of this process, you get this, say, omega minus 2 in the spectrum. So when omega is very large, it's omega minus 2. And when omega is very small compared, of course, to gamma, which is the damping rate, you basically see that it flattens off. And so this is a what we call a red noise process. But this is sort of the basis of sea surface temperature variability. So when you look at this, if you look at the discrete equivalent of this, it's called an AR1 process, and you plot this AR1 curves here. So these are the red and the fitted, say, AR1 spectra. You see that indeed, although again you have to be careful in terms of that you have not many data, but you see that indeed it falls off here nearly as an omega minus 2. And so this is called the null hypothesis. Any explanation you have on climate phenomena, right, or any time series which basically you claim that it's not due to noise, you have to show that statistically that it's that you can reject the null hypothesis. Right? It's an important, say, basic thing. So I'll show you, if you're interested, on Tuesday in El Nino, you can definitely reject the null hypothesis. This is certainly due not purely to noise in the mixed layer. This is certainly something else. But for many of the phenomena in climate, the data series are so limited that it's very hard to prove that you actually sort of, you're not looking at noise. So what this really happens in physics is that you have the high fluctuating phenomena and they're integrated by the lower, slow adjustment in the ocean thermally. And that gives you this red noise spectrum. Okay, so this is the what we call an artist's view of climate variability. And this is, of course, you cannot make this spectrum because you need a time series which is about 10 to the 7th year long with a resolution of a second or so. So you don't have this. That's why it's called an artist's view. But imagine this El Nino, say, part here. You have this Niño 3.4 time series, and you can, of course, you can make a spectrum individually from that particular point, and then you can make a composite diagram in terms of how strong this variability is in terms of sea surface temperature. And that gives you this curve, and it's interesting because you see that there's phenomena which is very peaky phenomena like the day and the year. Those are phenomena you don't have to explain in that sense. They're just externally forced. And then there's this background here where you see that the amplitude of the variability actually increases when you go to lower timescales. So the temperature differences in glacial interglacial phenomena is much bigger than the one due to El Niño, right? And this is also this red noise background signal. There's constantly this integration of small scales through the large scale slow phenomena in the system. And then the interesting thing is, of course, the peaks here. So the broadband signals where there's actually, say, variability which extends above this red noise. Now, there are a few phenomena where that's very clear, but for others, like here, the 3 to 7 days variability, it comes through the weather systems which go over the land and over the oceans, right? Which have a time scale of typically 3 to 7 days. So this is the summary. You have sharp peaks, you have this continuous red background, and then you have this elevated energy. And this is the system we try to understand. So now, how do you approach that? Well, this is in a nutshell is the how do you can approach it. You focus on a particular phenomenon. Take El Niño, for instance, and you focus on the dynamical processes which are sort of dominant in that causing that phenomena. So that's on the typical scale L. So that would be the Pacific Basin, and the temporal scale would be about 4 years. And that composes your deterministic dynamical model. But then you have unresolved processes, so there's many faster processes in the system, and which you have to represent in some way. And that's usually done in terms of noise. So you see already that you get a stochastic dynamical system. Of course, when you have, you have also boundary conditions and forcing, and usually they're fixed. So you can fix, for instance, the continental geometry, right, when you look at El Niño. When you look at, say, timescales of 100 millions of years variability, yeah, then the continental shift you have to take into account, and you get different boundary conditions. So it's really up to you how you choose this particular, say, focus of the phenomenon, but that determines how you approach this. And then, of course, you have a hierarchy of models on this. You're interested in this sort of behavior, or basically in statistics, over the full parameter space of these models. And of course, dynamical systems give you a nice, say, geometric interpretation of the motion. So, in definite, one person's noise can be another person's signal. It's just how you look at the particular phenomenon which you consider to be, say, dominant, which is your object of study. And so this is the hierarchy of climate models, and if you're interested, this is in chapter 6 of my book, Climate Dynamics, where I try to describe this hierarchy of models in terms of processes. So that means you can include only one process, like one wave propagation, or you can include only, for El Niño, only the ocean, the upper ocean, and very simple atmosphere. But what you can, if you sort of would increase the number of processes, you're looking into these models where you include, say, the biosphere or chemical transport, right? But so that's the number of processes. And then, of course, you have the number of scales. So that starts at the planetary scale, where you really look at the whole Earth. And eventually, you can go down to, well, the Kolmogorov scale, right? So the really smaller scale, which is relevant in the system. And that really says how much of the scale, spatial scales, do we resolve? And that leads to this kind of diagram, where you have very conceptual models, where you're interested in, where you usually capture a few processes, also a few scales, and can be useful for, say, explaining one particular phenomenon. And up to, say, the, this is the IPCC AR5 that I was talking about. This is, the report appeared last year. And of course, this model of development goes on and on. And we're now in a sort of range where people do simulations with 10-kilometer ocean, 50-kilometer atmosphere, covering sea ice, even land ice, biosphere, etc. So there's enormous development there at the modeling centers. Now, what I think is important is in this approach is what I call a minimal model. It's sort of quotes because it's not so well defined, but it means just enough processes to capture phenomena on the study. So if you leave out some of the phenomenon you represent, you don't get it anymore. This is basically the approach. I'll show you a model example later on. And it can be for phenomena. Different phenomena can be, of course, a very different minimal model. So, but the thing is, it is somewhere in the hierarchy. And the important is, when we try to do theory development of this phenomena, that if you look again at these more conceptual models versus these global climate models, then you can make this distinction between, say, the level of understanding. So if you have a conceptual model, you can understand basically all of what's going on, because you have this limited process and scales. It's very useful, but it's limited to that particular, say, phenomena it can represent, whereas it's often very difficult to sell to, say, that it can explain observations, because you know that observations are, of course, much more involved in many cases. On the other hand, you have this, enormously complicated models, and then it's important to deduce, so what's happening in those models? I mean, they're often as complicated as the observations. So you'd have to do really good analysis to really get these causal mechanisms out. And so here's what I think is, for mathematicians, very interesting. I mean, one is, of course, determining these causal relations in these models. There's basically time series analysis, pattern recognition, analysis of balances in those models, what's happening in a particular, say, how's the heat transported through the system. So this is an important thing, where you go from, say, this highly complicated models to know what's going on, but more in the conceptual models, which is also from the mathematical point much more interesting, because the problems are much easier, much better defined. You have to make a commitment that you trace these mechanisms also through the hierarchy. So if you find a mechanism in a very conceptual model, you shouldn't be satisfied. You have to actually go up to the hierarchy and show that it's relevant in, say, many more complex models. So this is the view I have on this on this theory development. And then from a dynamical systems, there's of course an enormous toolbox of techniques to do this. This is fantastic. Here is the Taylor-Couette flow picture here, where you have this cylinder as a typical dynamical system here, where the inner cylinder rotates. Often the outer signal is cylinder is fixed, and what you see is that if you increase the rotation rate, you go through all the stages of flow. You have a laminar flow, and then you get parallel flow, then you get Taylor vortices that become time dependent, and eventually you get turbulence. And when you look at that, of course, from a dynamical systems point of view, you view it in phase space, so you have fixed points, half bifurcations, limit cycles, tori, and more complicated sets. And all those, toolbox to analyze is available to analyze these models. Right? Now, I must admit that for the conceptual models, you can do more than you can do for, the more complicated, models. But that is all in development also to do that. And from the bifurcation theory, of course, many of you are familiar with that, all those techniques to do that. And you can use, for instance, continuation methods. I will talk about that on Monday also for high dimensional systems. And your interest in normal modes and global bifurcations, etc. And on the other hand, you can also use a lot of techniques from ergodic theory, like looking at, transfer operators, trying to devise invariant measures to compute those, etc. So these are is the computational side. But again, there's a whole toolbox available to handle, to analyze, the models of in climate. So let me give you one example, just to show you how this works. And so this is a phenomenon which is called the Atlantic Multidecadal Oscillation. And it's best explained by looking at first at the temperature of this box. So you take the temperature from the equator to 60 north, about this is the box is a little bit higher, but it's usually taken up to 60 north, or 70 north it's here. And what you do, you look at the temperature anomaly again with respect to this long-term mean, same as for ENSO. So here it's also from 1870 to, this is 2008 also, and you take the long-term mean and then you compute the anomaly, and you also, this green curve here, you take a, what is called a running mean, 10-year running mean, so you smooth the curve. And then you see that you have this variability where the Atlantic was colder than normal here in the, early 1900s. It's been warmer over this period here. Then there was a cool period, 70s and 80s, and now, again, over the last couple of years, the Atlantic has been warmer. So this suggests that, well, you have a oscillatory signal here in the Atlantic, but from this data, if you make a spectrum, it's sort of hopeless to get it above the red noise. Right? You have only one or two periods. So there's no way you can show that this is not noise, not red noise. It can be just integration of, high-frequency noise by the mixed layer ocean. There's a pattern associated with this, so what is usually done, you take this time series here and then you make a regression on the sea surface temperature anomaly field. And this regression coefficients here, can translate that back into sea surface temperature anomalies. And then you get this pattern, and you see it pretty much localized here in the North and North Atlantic. So south of Greenland, there's a broad signal also in the Atlantic South, but it's mostly located here. And so this gives an idea that, hey, it might be localized, if it's not noise, it might be localized in the North Atlantic, and there might be some dynamics going on. Now, one way to show that this is not noise is go back to other type of data, and not instrumental data. This is data, we call this instrumental data from 1970 to present day. But you can go back to what we call proxy data. And one of the proxy data is isotope records. So if you look at oxygen isotope 018, 016, if you look at those in air bubbles in ice cores, there's a relation between the ratio of this isotope 018, 016 and the temperature. And So when you do that, and this is, say, for five ice cores here on Greenland, it's a bit vague, but I hope you can see that it's in the north of Greenland. This is the center of Greenland, just two. So these are people went out to the ice, they dig a big core in depth, and then you can relate actually the time, so the depth of the core you can relate back to time at the time when the snow was deposited. You can count the layers. There's a whole age model you have to devise to do that. But this has been, of course, an enormous breakthrough in climate research in terms of that you can reconstruct climate history back in time. And these are five ice cores where you have annual resolution. So this is very high resolution measurements. And the five core composite is sort of that's added, all of them, is since the Middle Ages, so from 1300 to mid-1900, you can get these isotope records. And it shows you the temperature fluctuations on Greenland, right? So averaged over Greenland. And the curve here, the black curve, is sort of 31-year smooth curve. So you take a running mean over 31 years, shift that, and you compute this curve. And then you see that it shows quite some variability here. And when you then make a spectrum of that, then you see that, there's some details in there how you construct this, but if you look at, say, this is the 95%, say confidence level under red noise null hypothesis, and this is the red one, is the signal, and then you see that indeed you can barely, you can stand above the red noise, say, limit at about, for a period of about 20 to 30 years, so about 20 years. So this is the only way, actually, you can show that there might be sort of variability in the North Atlantic, which is not due to red noise. Right. And there are more records than this nowadays. I mean, I did this with Peter Cilek a while back, but there are many more papers showing that from the ice cores you have this variability, and there's also differences over the different, say regions here in Greenland. So this must be the convincing element that there is something going on which is not red noise. Right. Now, what's really happening, if you think about how would actually the temperature fluctuate on Greenland due to, say, dynamical effects, so it has to do with a flow structure, and the flow in the North Atlantic is, I put it up again just to show you. This is, of course, an animation, just a sketch of the flow, but it shows you the current path here in the Gulf Stream, so the red is the surface currents. It goes northward here, cools down, becomes heavy, sinks in a complicated way, sinks to the bottom, and then eventually goes below the Gulf Stream, and goes southward and goes into the Southern Ocean eventually. So there's a strong current also below the Gulf Stream which goes southward. It's called the Deep Western Boundary Current. And you can imagine that if you transport a lot of water northward by the surface current, so there's very warm water going northward by the Gulf Stream, that if it comes back sort of at the same level but flows southward, you don't have a lot of net heat transport. But if it really is the sinking, so the water sinks and there's cold water going southward, that you have a lot of heat transport. And so the actual sort of circulation which carries the heat transport, so is responsible for heat transport, is the zonally integrated circulation. So you integrate over the zonal direction, so going back here from Florida here to Africa, and then you compute a stream function in this meridional vertical plane. And this is called the meridional overturning stream function. And this is, at the moment we measure, that it's measured at 26 north. There's an array here in the North Atlantic, a very ingenious instrument from the Canary Islands to Florida here, where you basically measure, say, this transport, volume transport. And this volume transport, this is from a model, where you can actually compute it. And this is in Sverdrup, so to give you an idea, one Sverdrup is here, 10 a million, say, cubic meters per second, and the volume transport of the Amazon River is about 0.1 Sverdrup. So it gives you an idea how much volume transport you have. And so here in the contours, this is about 18 in this model, so that means that between this point, and this is at latitude about 30 north, and this is at depth about 1,000 meters, there's about, between this point and the surface, there's about 18 Sverdrup going northward. Of course, the Gulf Stream is much stronger. It's about 60 Sverdrups, But a lot of them is transported horizontally backwards at the same height. So you integrate that out. So the meridional overturning stream function is carrying the heat transport. And so when this changes, when this circulation changes strength, or there's less volume transport northward, you get less heat transport northward. Right? Because it transports heat from the warm areas here to the cold areas there. And so the temperature on Greenland, this is the main thing, can fluctuate by fluctuations in this circulation. It's a three-dimensional pattern, but the zonally integrated pattern is the one where if that fluctuates, you get this difference in heat transport. And that gives you eventually temperature changes on Greenland. And this mock, as I said, I'll use the name mock now for now because it's a long word. We measure it since 2004. So we have a 10-year time series now of this mock, only at one section, so it's only at 26 north. So it's very limited still, but it's something. Now, what is the minimal model here to define, to capture actually this Atlantic multi-decadal variability? And, what is important is that you have a temperature gradient here, which basically changes the density. So it's colder here, so you get higher density. So the water sinks in the north, and it comes up in the south. This is what you need. Now, of course, there's wind, and there's salt, and whatever, but the minimal model is you can leave out the salt, you still get the same phenomena. You leave out the wind, you still get the same phenomena. If you leave out the temperature, you get nothing, because then there's no flow. So this is how you work towards this minimal model. And you idealize the basin for the moment, so this looks like the North Atlantic, but of course it's very idealized, it's still a sector, it's a three-dimensional model. You cannot do it in two dimensions. You can try to get this phenomenon by looking only at the two-dimensional equivalent here. It does not work. You don't get this. So that you need these three dimensions. And then you have the governing equations, and I just put them up for people who know them. Nothing special. This is Navier-Stokes equations for the in Bushinesque approximation. So you have a velocity field U, you have a planetary rotation vector omega of the Earth, you have a pressure, you have a density here, which is only related to the temperature, so it's a linear equation of state you use. You have this is the mixing you have to represent, so look at the diffusion of momentum. And then you have the temperature equation, where you have this horizontal and vertical diffusion, which, because you have scale differences, the depth of the ocean is only 4 kilometers, and the extent is thousands of kilometers, so you have to take inhomogeneous, diffusions. But this is basically the equations you have to solve for this problem. And they don't differ a lot from normal convection-type problems, except this equation of hydrostatic. That's the difference, because you have this scale-height difference in of depth and length. And then you have to prescribe the interaction with the atmosphere, and you do that in two limits. So one is you prescribe the temperature from the atmosphere, so that means that the atmosphere will damp any temperature fluctuation in the ocean very quickly, because it really restored it to that particular temperature. And then you take the other limit, where you basically prescribe the heat flux, so QH is here the heat flux, like in the mixed layer model. You just have this heat flux, and you just prescribe it. But here you see that there's no damping involved in the atmosphere, because you can have any temperature anomaly in the ocean and the atmosphere doesn't do anything with it. So this is the two different limits, and you actually take a control parameter which switches between those limits. So one value of gamma is zero is this limit, and gamma is one is that limit. That's basically so you vary the atmospheric damping in physical terms. And that's basically it. So it's not a complicated model, but it's not a system of ODEs, of course. It's still a system of PDEs, three-dimensional spatially, which you have to address. But you can discretize this and then make a sort of define a dynamical system from this in finite dimensional form. Of course, it depends on your resolution, which you have. But typically, if you take 4-degree resolution of this, discretization, and sometimes we 2 degrees is sort of standard to do this, then you have a dynamical system which is about an order of 100,000. So that's relatively, I mean, it's big if you use the very low dimensional models, but it's small compared to the systems. If you have a global ocean, you're already in a few million. So this is relatively small. And then you treat this as a dynamical system, and you're just interested in what's going to happen when you vary gamma. So it's a one parameter problem, and you look at what kind of behavior you get in this model. Now this is what happens in a nutshell. So if you prescribe gamma 0, I just plot it here in terms of a transient. So what happens if you take gamma 0 and you start from an initial condition, you end up, and I just sketched it here as a long-term asymptotic behavior, then you end up with a steady value of this meridional overturning stream function, as is about 19 squared up here in this model. And it's just purely driven by the temperature difference, which sets up this density-driven flow. And now you switch to T is 0 here, you switch to gamma is 1. So you just prescribe this heat flux condition, so suddenly your atmospheric damping goes to 0. And then what you see, you get these spontaneous, say, fluctuations here, and they have a time scale, which is multidecadal. And of course you can change the parameters, and you can change this period also, but it's difficult to get it below, say, a few years, and it's also difficult to get it above a few hundred years, because of course you're restricted to the strength of the mean flow. So there's not... So this is really typical behavior which is related to, say, the size of the Atlantic and the forcing. Now, if you have the deterministic case, you can vary gamma, and you see that up to gamma is 0.85, you see this variability coming. So this is gamma, and you see here this is a norm of the sea surface temperature in the model. Now, if you look at what is the realistic damping in the atmosphere, it's about here. You're in the stable regime. So this means that if you would apply this, of course it's a very conceptual model, you would assume that this atmospheric damping is well can be well computed, and you can do that actually from observations, then you're actually in the stable regime. So you wouldn't see anything. But of course, the atmosphere is very noisy, as I told you for this null hypothesis, and so you add this atmospheric noise, and what you see is then that this is a different noise product, so Q is the noise in the atmospheric heat flux, ocean atmospheric heat flux, W means white noise, S means here you have a spatial correlation in the noise, here it's also spatially uncorrelated, and then here you have a temporal correlation in the noise. And you see that if you look at, say, the variability below this, say, in the subcritical regime for the deterministic case, you can easily get variability which is excited by the noise, and we can also understand why that happens, etc. So here you have this multi-decadal variability. It's either sort of sustained oscillatory behavior, but under the conditions of realistic atmospheric damping, you basically need noise to excite it. And this is also why many models, so many general circulation models, some models find this variability, other models don't. Right? And that just depends on sort of in which regime they are in terms of gamma or in terms of other parameters in the system, of course, which change also this boundary. But this is what you get in this simple model. Now, how does it look like? Well, this is somehow near the Hough bifurcation in the deterministic case. This is the sea surface temperature variability pattern. So, of course, it's a three-dimensional variability pattern, but this is only the surface signal in plot. And what you see is that, there's some propagation here from the west here to the western propagation here in the signal, and that's mostly characterizing, say, the sea surface temperature. You see also the scale; it's a large-scale pattern. This is in degrees here, so 10 degrees about 1,000 kilometers. So you see this is about 5,000 kilometers or so. So it's a really large-scale pattern. And you can deduce that where does the time scale come from? Well, it's actually due to the basin crossing time. So there's a temperature anomaly crossing the basin and eventually gets to the west, and that determines basically your time scale of the oscillation. And then what determines the pattern? Well, it basically is this pattern which gets amplified at the Hough bifurcation, and you can also deduce what is the amplification mechanism. I'm not going to explain that here, but because it needs some geophysical fluid dynamics, but it basically you can explain it. And then it's excited, as I said, you might need atmospheric noise. So to really go a little bit deeper to explain the mechanism, so there's a little bit of fluid mechanics now, because you might be interested to know why what this is in this model. There's a very simple, say, experiment you can do. Oops. So this is on the rotating table. You can do it at home also if you want to. Here is a nice cylinder here. It's a room temperature here in the outer regions. So here's the ice cube. You put some dye in there, and what you get is that because of this density difference, so it's cool here, so this is the polar region, this is the equator region, and what you get because of this temperature difference here, you get density difference, and you get what is called a thermal wind flow, and it sets up a flow which is, I hope you can see that, which is sort of circulating around, say here, the ice, so in here in the anti-clockwise direction. It's basically due to the combination of buoyancy forcing creating pressure differences, and you have a Coriolis force which deflects it. So just to show you the experiment on how you can demonstrate, say, what kind of flow you get. And now what is this mechanism for this multi-decadal variability? Well, basically somehow a repeated cycle of this thermal wind flow. So you look at the temperature normally here in the west, temperature normally here in the north of the basin, it basically defines a temperature gradient here which is positive, temperature normally gradient which is positive, and it creates also this, by the thermal wind, it creates this flow which is now, say, in this direction, and so it propagates in the surface, it propagates this anomaly westward, and so quarter period later, so P is here period, quarter period later you get, say, this temperature gradient. And also there you get a temperature, you get this flow based on this thermal wind balance, you get it in this direction. And so this cold anomaly propagates here to the west, and eventually you get the reverse circulation as this one, and this is the propagation mechanism. So it's sort of a repeated thermal wind balance. So this is the detail of the mechanistic view you can deduce from those models. Right? Now to finalize, to show you, of course there's a lot of steps now in between you have to do to show that this mechanism is really something you see also in more complicated models. I'm not going to do that because of time also. I'm just going to show you that if you go eventually to observations, right, can you find this characteristic propagation? Now this is a typical result from a model, from the same model. Here it has wind and it has salt, so it's a little bit more complicated. It has also continental boundaries. In there, so it's a level up in the hierarchy in terms of what you include in the forcing, but you can show that it's still the same mechanism which creates this westward propagation. Now this is what they call the Hofmiller diagram. So this is the zonal direction. So here you have again you have U.S. and you have Europe here, and what you get, what you plot in time, you plot the anomalies along a section. So you get this propagating motion. You can see. In this model. Now this is from the available very sparse data. So here this is from we call the XPT data. So ships throw instruments overboard and they measure the temperature at the surface. And what you see is, well, of course it's very limited, but you see some westward propagation in the upper ocean. You see also that this global warming signal here, this is not filtered or whatever, this is the raw data later on, which also makes it troublesome to really make a good comparison. Now if you look at basically peak to peak, say sea surface temperature anomaly, so you look at situation here and you subtract the situation here and then you look at the spatial pattern, you get this spatial pattern in the model. Of course you see the continents at this resolution are included here. And when you do that in the observations, it's been done already earlier, in the early 2000, people reconstructed these patterns already, and then you get this pattern. And you can say, well, of course, it can be wrong, but it doesn't look bad. Right? This is really, it's not falsifying, say, this particular mechanism in this case. And people have found also this variability, they found it also in more complex models. So this sketches a bit this approach. You start with a minimal model, you do this dynamical systems analysis, you look at what is the dominant mechanism, and then, I didn't show you that very much in detail, but then you try to show that actually that mechanism is also in the models in the up in the hierarchy, you have the same mechanism. And then you can you have a result saying, okay, Well, this might be an explanation for what you see in observation. Okay, so I summarize. I showed you some sea surface temperature variability patterns. There's many acronyms there, so you get used to it when you're in the field. After a while, ENSO is El Niño, Southern Oscillation, Atlantic Multidecadal Oscillation. I showed you on this null hypothesis, on this red noise spectrum. And then looked at this climate model hierarchy, briefly touched on this, say, techniques we have from dynamical systems, and then showed you an example where we looked at this Atlantic Multidecadal Oscillation and showed you the mechanism of the thermal Rossby wave. So thank you very much. I'm happy to answer any questions.
Deep water formation and the possibility of regime shifts. Is that happening north of the regions that are relevant to the models that you're looking at? Or is
it's in a different regime. So I have to go back to this picture here. So this is the meridional overturning. This is where you have regime shifts off. And what is important is that when you get fresh water input from, for instance, melting land ice, Greenland, or even from sea ice also, then you change the density here in the northern part, you decrease the sinking here, and what happens then is that you decrease basically the strength of this meridional overturning, so there will be less heat transport northward. So that's a negative feedback, because your density eventually is going to increase. But you get also less salt transport, because it's saltier here than in the north. And so you amplify this perturbation. So any meltwater coming into the North Atlantic undergoes this feedback. And this is why you get the regime shifts. And this is outside of what we consider here, because we not consider, say, the freshwater anomaly, the freshwater forcing in the regime where you have these transitions. We just look at what is present day, what is the forcing there.
So is it a big change to try to include that possibility in the model?
No, that has been done also. Yeah.
And they show also results.
You have basically a two saddle knot, back-to-back saddle knot structure. And you find transitions from where this flow can actually totally reverse. Also, you see that in quite, say, models quite up in the hierarchy. Yeah.
Please.
So, a bit earlier in your talk, you had the data of the El Niño. And you said, okay, we can see from the data that it looks about every 4 years. and then you went to your artist impression thingy.
Yeah.
And okay. I was just staring at that a little bit, thinking like, okay, where are my peaks? And it doesn't seem to be a four-year peak. Am I right?
Well, it's here.
There's a two and a half? Or
yeah,
is it that one?
This is an old picture from Mitchell in 1978. So actually, you should be better.
Oh, you didn't have the really good data yet.
Yeah, 78 is before really the good El Niño data.
So what is so special about your every 4 years from the observation? I mean, this picture somehow makes you feel like, well, it could be any time. It's not really periodic, is it? Or is it?
No. Oh, you mean where the four-year time scale of El Niño comes from? This is really specific, the explanation of this peak here.
Yeah.
This is very well known.
Yeah, but this is a very defined peak, right?
Yeah.
It's the largest
that's
one.
Right.
And,
yeah.
and that artist impression, that's also El Niño.
It's an artist impression.
Oh.
And it's an old one. There are updated ones where you have the relative magnitude of the peaks are adjusted, but I like to use this old picture.
Yeah.
I mean, this
so
is
if you would
nice
make a new one, you would expect that at this roughly 4, you would have a better peak.
Yeah, although this is quite a broad peak also, huh? So it's between, I mean, this is between 2 and 9 years or so. So it's not a very sharp peak. So this is in the Mitchell picture somehow spread out.
I mean, you're explaining some very high-dimensional models in terms of some very low-dimensional phenomena.
Yeah. Yeah.
Is this a miracle, or is there some way to understand why this happens?
Yeah, that's a very good question. It shows you that here if you look at the large scale, so this is the large scale phenomenon, that there actually might be low dimension dynamics sort of involved in the large scale flow. But indeed, I mean, if you want to show that this mechanism is also present in the turbulent flow, which it, of course the ocean is, you need to do a lot more work. And this is something which I imagine when you go through the hierarchy and show actually that in a strongly, say, eddying ocean, that also this large-scale variability is present due to this mechanism. That's not been done. So it's a very good point. But we try to explain many of the phenomena, we try to explain by this large-scale feature. If you look at El Niño, for instance, the whole El Niño theory is also very low-dimensional, whereas it also is in a very complex system. And there are many, of course you have so good data that you can actually, I mean, there's quite good data from over a 20, 30-year period. So you can actually look at a lot more detail in terms of verification. And that seems to work pretty fine in El Niño. But we don't know it for this 50-year variability. Yeah.
Now, in your testing of the AMO against the null hypothesis, mm-hmm. I had no sense as to whether that was a strong positive, a weak positive, given
yeah.
the field, or barely. Could you give a little sense of how strong that?
Well, barely. Yeah.
Okay,
yeah.
So it looks
so but at least you see that, I mean, it's 95% confidence.
Yeah.
That's well, we consider that still as being enough, but I mean, if you look at theoretical physicists, they go to 5 standard deviations, right?
But if you did the same for El Niño, what would that picture
look like? Oh, that's certainly above. Yeah. So much more clear.
Okay.
Yeah. I don't have the picture quickly, but I'll have on Tuesday, and it really is much clearer. One, because it's shorter time scale, so you have a lot more data to do that, and much more accurate data also. And so it's more clear there. So this is actually, ENSO is the only phenomenon where we really know for sure that it's above red noise. This is, there may be glacial cycles, there's also something, you have enough data. Yeah.
You know, you're looking over the globe and mm-hmm. over different timescales. So with El Niño, there seems to be a very clear spatial structure. I mean, if you look at these pictures,
yeah.
it is
yeah.
in a very narrow band compared
yeah.
to how big the Earth is. Is there
yeah.
any underlying geological insight why it is concentrated where it is? I
yeah.
mean, which
yeah.
would be additional, you know, confirmation
yeah.
that it's really there?
Yeah,
What's
I mean, it's
argument?
Really trapped here because of the equatorial wave structure. So that because the Earth is a sphere, you have that this Coriolis force changes sign right at the equator, and so you have really that gives you the trapping of old motion near the equator, so function decaying by e to the power minus y squared, and this is really why it's so localized near the equator.
Yeah, it's a totally different argument from the red. Red noise hypothesis in some sense?
No, well, it gives you only a clue on the spatial structure, not on whether it's
yeah. significant or not.
Yeah, you could say if it would be red noise, you wouldn't have the spatial structure, but that's not the case, I think. I think you can... Because it's also related to the background state. And so if you... The background state, I cannot explain that at the moment,
maybe.
But the background state is controlling also the flow, and I think when you add noise to this background state, you might also get this picture.
Yeah. So for El Niño, you're saying we have enough data going back to say we can say it's a process,
mm-hmm.
it's some sort of phenomenon every 4 years. But we don't really have, do we really have enough for the super El Niños? Like we're having a really strong one coming this year.
Mm-hmm.
Do we have enough data to say that that's somehow different from the other El Niños? Or
yeah, it's difficult to make this sort of catalog of different El Niños. People have tried to do that. There's a recent paper in the Bulletin of American of the AMS also. I don't think, I mean, if you look at extreme events, you don't have enough data to actually do that type of analysis. But I also, I mean, people are talking about different, I mean, there's now two flavors of El Niño, right? One is the sort of cold tongue warm pool, that's the one here. And then you have the what's called Modoki El Niños, which are more in the Central Pacific. To me, it doesn't make sense really to distinguish this very much because it's all a little bit. I mean, there are three feedbacks in the system, and it's all a little bit how the feedbacks sort of are different. You get kind of different patterns. And so it's the same phenomena, I would say, but different expressions. But now, for extreme events, I mean, you have to do a lot more. Although there are a lot of choral data back now, where you can look at epoxy data for much longer, so look at extremes, for instance.
It's good. I remind you all before we thank Hank finally that we have some refreshments next door around down the hall, I believe. Let's thank Hank.